City. This is Charlie Rose.
Quentin Tarantino is here. He burst into the film world in 1992 with his movie Reservoir Dogs. His second effort, Pulp Fiction, turned him into an icon in the film world. His movies often mix sparkling dialogue with sensationalized violence. Here is a look at some of his work.
Is that supposed to be funny? Look, we think this place ain't safe.
This place just ain't secure anymore. We're leaving. You should go with us.
Nobody's going anywhere.
And you know what they call a quarter pounder with cheese in Paris?
They don't call it a quarter pounder with cheese?
I mean, they got the metric system. They wouldn't know what the quarter pounder is.
And what do they call it?
They call it a Royale with cheese.
Royale with cheese.
That's right.
What do they call a Big Mac?
Well, Big Mac's a Big Mac, but they call it Le Big Mac.
Le Big Mac. What do they call a Whopper?
I don't know. I didn't go on a Burger King.
Beauty case.
Mm-hmm. What's in it?
Beauty products. Alarm clock. Glass case. Birth control.
What's that?
My diet.
Let's see what else is in there.
Here.
What's this?
服部半蔵に一体何の用ですか?
日本刀が必要で。一体日本刀を何に使うんですか?切りたいネズミがいるから。You
must have big rats. You need a Hattori Hanzo's steel.
Huge.
If you want to be old school about it, and you know, I'm all about old school. Then we could wait until dawn and slice each other up at sunrise like a couple of real life, honestly. Now, if you don't settle down, I'm gonna have to put one in your kneecap. And I hear tell that's a very painful place to get shot in.
Well, Pam, which way are you going? Left or right?
Right.
That's too bad.
Why?
Well, because it was a 50-50 shot on whether you'd be going left or right. You see, we're both going left. You could have just as easily been going left, too, and if that was the case, it would have been a while before you started getting scared. But since you're going the other way, I'm afraid you're gonna have to start getting scared immediately.
Tarantino's latest film may be his most ambitious yet. Inglourious Basterds features a band of Jewish American Nazi hunters who unleash a plot to end the Second World War. Here is a look at the trailer.
Ten Hut!
I'm putting together a special team. We're gonna be doing one thing and one thing only. Killing Nazis.
Sound good?
Yes, sir!
I'm gonna assume you know who we are.
Everybody in the German army's heard of you.
You probably heard we ain't in the prisoner-taking business. We in the killing Nazi business. And cousin, business is booming. If you ever wanna eat a sauerkraut sandwich again, take your wiener schnitzel licking finger and point out on this map what I wanna know.
I respectfully refuse.
Hey, Donnie! Guy's a German here, wants to die for country. Oblige him.
An American Secret Service outfit lives deep behind enemy lines. The Germans call them the bastards. These Yanks have been them the devil.
We're all tickled to hear you say that.
The Germans are throwing a gala premiere. In attendance will be most of the German high command.
You'll rendezvous with our double agent. She'll take it from there.
You're getting us in that premiere.
It's suicide.
What else are we gonna do? Go home?
So what's the plan? We punch those goons out, take their machine guns, and burst in there, blast them.
Is that the plan?
That's about it. Or not.
There's something you don't know. Hitler is attending the premiere.
Getting a whack Uncle Adolf makes this a horse of a different color.
We have all our rotten eggs in one basket. The objective of the operation, blow up the basket.
Give you a little something you can't take on.
You're getting pretty good at that.
You're now in the hands of the SS. My hands, to be exact.
Yes.
I am pleased to have Quentin Tarantino back at this table. Welcome.
Yeah, it's good to be back. Actually, that was if I say so myself, that was a fun little oeuvre. Right? I was kind of getting off of my own work there for
exactly.
a second.
A body of work right there. So what is a Tarantino film?
Oh, gosh, I might not be the best person to describe that.
Well, I once read where you said that I can do film criticism as good as anybody I've ever read.
I would agree. I'm probably not Pauline Kael and maybe short of Andrew Serres, but after that. Part of the... Actually, one of the things is, you know... Actually, a good way to describe this is, like, in this movie, for example, people have asked me questions about, like, well, were you concerned about the level of humor that's in a World War II film? I mean, there's not really been a lot of humorous World War II movies made in the last 30 years. And were you worried about that? And it was like, I can't help it. That's just kind of what I do. You know, when I write these stories and then and humor comes out of it. And, so it's, if that stuff wasn't in there, if the set pieces, if the kind of love of cinema, if the humor, if that wasn't in there, I would question my authorialship. I probably wasn't done by me.
Dialogue is one great thing for you. Mm-hmm. Some sense of, you all have always liked a camera in motion, too.
Yeah.
That goes around.
Right, yeah.
You like, what else? Tell me what are the elements for you that you want to see in your films because they represent a Tarantino signature.
Well, you know,
music is another.
Yeah, that's definitely one of them. But, like, I guess when it comes to the actual writing of the piece where it really, really becomes what it's going to become, is it's about character. And the dialogue just comes out of the character. And I don't lead the characters. I let the characters lead me, both as far as who they are and the conversations and even the scenario itself. I mean, like, for instance, if I've got a character here with this glass and I have every intention of getting him to where that glass is, well... That's a good idea on my part, I think. Yeah. But once I get them going there, they might reject the glass.
Right.
And they go somewhere else. And they are the ones that know best.
Yeah, and when you're writing that, are you thinking of particular actors in mind?
You know, it's all different. All right. Actually, in this movie in particular, almost everybody I didn't have anybody in mind at all. And I actually think it's one of the reasons why the characters became so vivid is because it was more like a novel. I wasn't thinking about actors or their limitations. It's one of the reasons, like, the character Colonel Landad speaks so many languages. I didn't have to worry about that. But in the case of, like, say, Kill Bill, that was completely designed for Uma Thurman.
It came out of Pulp Fiction.
Yeah, exactly.
You knew her. You wanted to make a movie.
Yeah, and that was like, I'm actually building the movie around her. I couldn't do it without her.
So if I said to you, you have always wanted to make this movie, what would I be talking about?
Well, you know, it's funny. I think in particularly in this case, is part of the thing that I like to do is I like genre. I like working in genre. And I like working very personally and very minutely inside of a fun movie genre. And I even like the subgenres inside of genre. So, like, in the case of this being a war movie, it's not just a war movie. It's a bunch of guys on a mission movie. That's kind of what it is I do. In another movie, it could be a Western. Another movie could be a swashbuckler.
Does that mean you're going to do a Western and you'll do a musical? And, I mean, you try to, in a life career span, you'll touch most genres?
More or less, yes. I mean, I started off with crime films, but I didn't want to just go down that road. I mean, it's been a while since I've done a crime film, so I actually might go back and visit it again because I think now it would be fresh. But I do like genres. I do want to make a Western. I keep kind of making these half-ass Westerns, you know, that aren't really officially Westerns. But even, like, when you bring up musicals, that might be one I don't know if I'd do because I like the musical aspects that are in my movie right now. Right. I get in and get out whenever I want.
This movie, how long did it take you to write it?
Well, it's... You know, I came up with the idea about 10 years ago, in 1998.
And the idea was?
Well, the idea was, let me do a bunch of guys on a Mission War movie. And
so this was Dirty Dozen.
Yes, exactly.
Plus.
Yeah, so I thought of the idea. I came up with most of the characters that you see in the movie now. And I came up with the idea of the character Aldo Raine, played by Brad Pitt, who leads these Jewish-American soldiers behind enemy lines to basically do an Apache resistance against right. the Nazis. So I had that in my head. Shoshana in mind, the character that Melanie Laurent plays.
Right.
And then I had the first two chapters written, which is, it's a chapter structure. I had those first two chapters. But I had a different storyline in mind. And I was writing that, and it was just too big. It was just, it wouldn't have been a movie. It could have been a miniseries, maybe, but it wasn't a movie. People were saying that I had writer's block. I had the opposite of writer's block.
Yeah,
I could
much.
Not shut my brain off. I couldn't stop writing. And also, you have to remember, back in 98, this would have been my first original since Pulp Fiction, so I was very precious about the whole thing. So I put it aside and decided to go to Kill Bill to tame myself. Cut to Kill Bill, Volume 1 and 2.
Right.
I had epicitis at that time. So when I came back to it in 2008... I realized it was that story that was just too all-encompassing. So I got rid of that story and came up with a new story. And that new story was the whole idea of a German Audie Murphy soldier, played by Frederick Zoller, and who's done this wonderful thing for Germany, right at a bad time in the war for them. And so Joseph Goebbels is going to make a movie about him, and there's going to be a premiere. And then the actual mission, the Guns of the Navarone section, would be blowing up the premiere.
Yes, I can see
the movie on the Navarone.
And the idea of cinema in this movie is everywhere.
Yeah, exactly.
It takes place at a cinema.
Yeah.
Goebbels love movies.
Mm-hmm.
And you love movies.
Yeah.
So tell me where it all comes together.
Well, the thing that kind of cracked me up was there's a scene early on in the movie where you're really being introduced for the first time fully to the Shoshana character who's a Jewish woman. Her whole family was murdered by the Nazis, and you cut to her 4 years later and she's hiding inside of Paris, and she owns a cinema. And that Frederick Zoller character I talked about is a German soldier who likes movies too and starts talking to her. And he's kind of chatting her up a little bit.
And he's going to be in a movie because he's a war hero.
Yeah, he's a war hero. Yeah, it's kind of like an Audie Murphy kind of fellow, but for Nazis. And all of a sudden they're talking, and I'm writing this script. Again, I don't know exactly what they're going to say. I get them talking, and they do it. And so all of a sudden they start having a conversation about Max Linder versus Charlie Chaplin versus Pabst versus Lene Riefenstahl. And when the whole scene's over and I put the pen down, I'm like, man, I go to do a World War II movie, and it ends up being a love letter to cinema. I just cannot not, apparently. But, you know, even the whole – but I actually was really fascinated once I got up the idea of doing the whole Nazi propaganda film as a premiere. Just the whole idea of dealing with German cinema under the Third Reich. That's really never been done before. Even dealing with Joseph Goebbels, not as necessarily the architect of evil as he's always presented, but as his job as a studio head, which was one of his main jobs.
Right, right.
You know,
and he fancied himself David O. Selznick, did he? Or?
Yeah. Well, he was a very he considers himself a very artistic producer. And he had made over 800 films, and except for the movies of Leni Riefenstahl, he had his hand in almost every single one of them. Well, one thing that
nothing to do with hers.
No, he wasn't allowed to. That was the one he had control over. Everybody in the German film industry with the sole exception of Leni Riefenstahl.
Because she was Hitler's favorite.
She was Hitler's favorite, and they despised each other. But she was the one that did not have to cow down to him. But you know one thing I thought was really interesting is I read Goebbels' diaries preparing for this movie, and he had some very, very interesting takes on cinema. And he had some very, very interesting takes on propaganda itself. Like, for instance, when he saw Battleship Potemkin,
All right.
He thought it was brilliant technique, but very bad propaganda. He thought it was too heavy-handed. He said if it had been less heavy-handed, softer on the propaganda side, but just as much technique, it could have accomplished far more.
I can't imagine. Is there anybody that was better propaganda than he was, albeit for evil purpose?
Yes, exactly. Well, you know, what he considered the greatest piece of propaganda of the war, and he spent a long time trying to duplicate it, was William Wyler's Mrs. Miniver. That really stirred up
so
the home front.
So he knew cinema, too.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, that was, you know, that really boned up the home front in England. And he spent a lot of his career trying to recreate a Mrs. Miniver for Germany.
Okay, so we've got the cinema ideas there. Revenge is there.
Yeah.
There is Dirty Dozen. There is sort of the Cherokee idea, which is we're going to go in there, we're going to kill them, we're not taking prisoners, and we're going to scalp them, and we're going to leave a mark.
Yeah, the idea there, the idea behind them doing an Apache resistance is the idea that they'll ambush seven soldiers, say, all right, and they kill them, and they take their scalps, and they desecrate the bodies and leave them there for the Germans to find. It's not about those seven guys they killed.
Sure.
It's about the story that's going to go about the bastards and how it's going to get into the psyche of the German soldier.
Now, how did you create the idea of the German guy who was, in fact, his great... He was a sleuth.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, played
that's
by
that's exactly, how
that's
I think
exactly
about
what
him.
He was.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was a guy who would find out where the Jews were.
Yeah. His name is Colonel Hans Landa, played by Christoph Waltz. And his nickname that the Jews have given him in France is the Jew Hunter.
Yeah. And we'll talk about the acting in a minute. How did you create the character? What was it based on? Or was that simply out of your mind?
He just flowed out of me. I mean, I really can't really tell you, well, I did this or I did that. I think the first scene that I wrote in the movie was the opening scene. I always have to kind of write in order. The opening scene in the film where he's interrogating the French farmer at the film.
But then you believe then that that character is fully formed in your mind because the dialogue that takes place, the mannerisms that take place continue through the film in every encounter he has.
He's not really fully formed. I mean, they grow. They teach me who they are. Like, to give you an example, one of the things about his character that's one of the most striking things is he's obviously a linguistic genius. Well,
right.
I didn't know that when I wrote that first scene. I knew he could speak French. But I didn't know that he was such a linguistic genius until he just kept being able to speak one language after another.
Then did you have to find an actor who could do that?
Oh, yeah. That was the thing. That was the big deal. I mean, one of the things, when I finished that script, I knew that Colonel Landa was one of the greatest characters I've ever written and one of the greatest characters I will ever write.
Hans Landa is played by Christoph Waltz, a German actor.
Yes, yeah.
A German actor who was not at the height of his career.
No. He's a TV actor in Germany.
And in fact, he said at Cannes, he basically, in a very emotional moment, said, "You had given back his career."
Yeah.
And you said something interesting, too. Mm-hmm. You gave me my movie.
Yeah, no, that's very true.
I mean, that dialogue could hardly be written, couldn't it?
Yeah, no. It's a thing, like I was saying before, when I wrote that script, I just knew that Landa was I'm aware enough to know one of my best creations I've ever written, and he was one of them.
But, okay, let me just understand that.
Sure.
A great creation has, first of all, he's larger than life in some way, or he has mannerisms that are defining, or he has a style.
Well, I guess it's more.
He has a look. He has what?
I think it's, I've been doing this for like 17 years now, so I do have a little rogues gallery of characters that are like my characters. And he was just one of the strongest that had ever come out. And then maybe in some way he revealed himself more to me as far as like I really let the character live. So I discovered him as I was writing him.
What's interesting about him is that he does everything with drama.
Yeah.
Every set piece is a dramatic piece. Whether it is because he discovered a shoe at a scene of a massacre.
Yeah, yeah.
And he knows where to go find the person who the shoe belongs to, rather than just saying, is this your shoe?
Yeah, yeah.
As an elaborate ritual.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's the thing is, everything Landa does, he is a detective. That's first and foremost where he's coming from. He's a detective. And everything he does, his scenes are basically almost all interrogation scenes.
At a moment, he says that it's somewhere in the
book. Yeah, that's it, yeah. And every scene he does is some version of an interrogation. And every piece of interrogation is a piece of theater or a mind game with the participant. I'll just give you an example. And there was also, it helps describe how me and Christoph worked on the film. Just to give you an idea, in the script, in the opening scene, when he's interrogating this French farmer, the French farmer takes out a pipe and starts smoking it. And at some point, Landa says, "Hey, can I take out my pipe?" And he goes, "Yes." And he pulls out this big giant calabash, which is the pipe that Sherlock Holmes smokes. And it's a very funny moment when it happens.
And he drinks milk.
Yeah, and he drinks the farmer's, he's a dairy farmer, so he drinks his milk as opposed to wine. But he has this pipe. And so I wrote that in the script. And then I actually had a couple of more moments where I had Landa take out the pipe and, smoke and think. And so it was obvious it was Landa's pipe. But I started thinking about it more and more as pre-production was going on, and I had dinner with Christoph, and I asked him, I go, let me ask you a question. In the script, it implies that this is definitely Londa's pipe, and he uses it to think. But let me ask you a question. What if Londa doesn't smoke a pipe? He knows the farmer smokes a pipe. And so at a certain point, he brings out this pipe. And what pipe does he bring out? He brings out the Sherlock Holmes pipe. One, you can say it's a sexual thing because my pipe's bigger than yours. All right. And the other thing, you can say, I know you're lying and I got you. I've got the Sherlock Holmes pipe. You know, so maybe he doesn't smoke a pipe at all. It's simply just an interrogation technique to throw the farmer, send him more to hell. And I so what do you think, Christoph? He goes, no, he doesn't smoke a pipe at all. It is simply an act of theater.
If one were to determine what attribute the German people share with a beast, it would be the cunning and the predatory instinct of a hawk. But if one were to determine what attributes the Jews share with a beast, it would be that of the rat. If a rat were to walk in here right now as I'm talking, would you greet it with a saucer of your delicious milk?
Probably not.
I didn't think so. You don't like them. You don't really know why you don't like them. All you know is you find them repulsive. Consequently, a German soldier conducts a search of a house suspected of hiding Jews. Where does the hawk look? He looks in the barn, he looks in the attic, he looks in a cellar, he looks everywhere he would hide. But there's so many places it would never occur to a hawk to hide. However, the reason the Führer's brought me off my Alps in Austria and placed me in French cow country today is because it does occur to me. Because I'm aware what tremendous feats human beings are capable of once they abandon dignity.
He won the Cannes Film Festival Best Actor Award.
Yeah, deservedly.
So the other characters, the two women.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's funny because the character of Shoshana.
Brad will speak for himself.
Yeah, exactly. The three characters that have been in my mind for the last 10 years in particular would be Brad's character Aldo Rain, Hans Landa, and then the character Shoshana Dreyfus, played by Melanie Laurent. And Shoshana in the film is a Jewish woman, a Jewish young girl, who saw her family massacred by the Nazis, and she's been hiding in Paris. And the thing is, with Shoshana, years ago, when I wrote the character, I had her much, much more of like being a real badass. And she was killing Nazis, and she had a list of officers. She was like a real Joan of Arc of the Jews. And, you know, she'd snipe Nazis from the rooftops of Paris and all this kind of stuff.
I like this.
And it was a lot of fun, all right? And I wrote these really great action sequences for Shoshana, and that was the deal.
So why didn't we use them?
Well, because I put it away, and I did Kill Bill. And almost everything that I liked about Shoshana, I gave to the bride. And so the bride did all that stuff. Yeah, right. And the bride's the one with a list. And the bride's the one going down the list. And kicking butt. So when I come back to it after Kill Bill, I go, well, I can't do this again. But what I liked about that aspect was it actually enabled me to make Shoshana more realistic. As opposed to being this tough Joan of Arc girl, she's a survivor. Mm-hmm. She's a survivor. It actually made her much more like Jackie Brown than the bride, because I think Shoshana's strength is keeping it together in tight situations where anyone else would crumble, when anyone else would melt. She manages to keep her poise.
Were they planning to go down in flames with everybody else, or did they think they were going to be able to get away because what they did mm-hmm. was on film?
Yeah, Shoshana is thinking she's going to go up with the theater. You know, she can't imagine living through something like this. So it is a suicide mission on her part. As far as the bastards are concerned, if the first group, which is not, I don't want to explain right now, but if the first group were to get in, they could actually drop the bombs off and get out.
Right.
But when Brad's group goes in, they're such bumbling idiots as far as their situation that, let's just get us in the building. If we can get in the building, we'll let off the bombs, all right? We don't have to pull this off 100%. Just get us in the building.
So,
and then the case of the other female character, Bridget von Hammersmark, played by Diane Kruger.
It was a brilliant German actress.
Yeah, she's terrific. She's terrific.
Real character?
She is. There's a lot of shadow things in this movie where I take a real life thing and I do a shadow version of it. And her character to me is based on two characters. One, there is a Hungarian actress that came to Hollywood named Ilona Massey, and I just kind of based it on like if Bridget von Hammersmark had gone to Hollywood during the Dietrich craze, her career would have been like Ilona Massey. But the thing that I was really thinking about is there was a singer and actress in Germany at the time named Zara Leander. And she was really the Nazi poster child. She's a big chanteuse and big singer and started in tons of musicals. Now, this is not for sure. It's just a rumor. But as much as a Nazi poster child as she was, there's a rumor, because in my movie, Bridget von Hammersmark, it has that kind of cachet with the Germans, but she's actually working for England. Zara Leander, rumors exist that she was actually working for the Soviet Union.
Oh, I know. I know the story. Exactly.
And so, it's a shadow thing.
Weren't there two of them that were working for the Soviet Union?
Well, there was somebody else, too. I can't remember. Yeah. But Zara Leander.
Who both of them were working for the Soviet
exactly.
Union.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. And Zara Leander was the one. That's one of the things that
gave you the idea.
It gave me the idea.
To create this storyline. Or what do you call it when you create a backstory for an actor?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you create a backstory for an actor.
Right.
And for the character. I mean, that's one of my things. Whether or not the audience knows about it, I know about the character's past, and I just want the actors to know. Now, the audience doesn't need to know. Like, for instance, Brad Pitt's character, Aldo Raine, has a rope burn.
Exactly.
Around his neck. But I never wanted to explain what happened.
I desperately wanted to know.
Well, I want you to just figure it out, all right? I mean, it's up to you to supply where that rope burn came from.
I mean, I would love to have had a little bit of a conversation that he would have referred to that.
Yes, if I wanted you to know, I would have told you. I like the idea
But your idea of cinema, then, is it to keep a lot of stuff in. You want mystery in the film itself.
You know, it's like
you want us not to know everything.
Well, I like the idea that, if you contemplate why there is a rope burn there, and somebody else contemplates why there is a rope burn there, and somebody else contemplates it, and three different people come up with three different reasons why he got a rope burn, those are three different movies you all saw. And I like that idea. I like the idea that you open up the briefcase in Pulp Fiction, and I don't tell you what's in there, but it's up to you to figure out what's in there, and now that's your movie. And you'll make that decision somewhere down the line. Now, if I tell you at this table what it is, then you'll throw that away, and I don't want you to throw away. That's your movie.
All right. In the end, this is a movie. It's a revenge movie? In the end?
I go for that.
But didn't Eli Roth say it was a...
It's kosher porn.
Kosher porn. Yeah. What did he mean by that?
I think what he meant by that was, I've been waiting to see this for a long time, watching Jews bash the heads in of Nazis is almost sexual gratification.
And scalp them and everything else.
Exactly, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and beat them up with him. And he's in the film.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, he plays the bear Jew. Donnie Donowitz.
Now, there was a story that I read that originally you wanted Stallone and Bruce Willis and others. Does that have any merit at all?
No, those are all terrific actors. I've worked with Bruce Willis. But as you can see from the movie, there's not a part for them. I don't see them playing Jews.
No.
All right. But no, that was just internet rumors.
All right. The movie you made is 2.5 hours. How long? 2:52?
Not that long. It's actually shorter than Pulp Fiction. It's 2 hours and 30 minutes.
And that's about right for you?
No, I think it's paced just fine. I wanted it to, I was more disciplined on the writing of the script than I'd been in a while as far as just the script writing was concerned. Because I didn't want it to be a 3-hour movie. And it's the kind of movie that could easily be something like that, especially the way I write. And then also even the thing is, because I wanted to make the Cannes Film Festival, I didn't have time to muck about.
You did it in 6 weeks, didn't you?
Yeah, exactly. Well, a little longer than that.
Why did you do that? Why couldn't you make the Cannes Film Festival in 2010?
Oh, man, that'd just be too far away, man. You know, I wanted to...
And you were convinced you could do it?
Yeah, I was convinced I could do it, or at least, you know, give it the old college try.
So
but I know if I'm going to climb that mountain, I'll make it. But I also liked the idea of bringing more of a disciplined aspect to the film in itself. Look, when you get to be a director in my lucky situation that I'm in, you don't make yourself normally less comfortable. You make yourself more comfortable. And that can be all well and good, but maybe you shouldn't be so
No, you don't believe that at all, that you should be more comfortable.
No, I don't, but it kind of starts happening, though. Yeah. And if you didn't finish the scene, there's always manana. I took away manana.
Where is it inside of you, some sense of where the brass ring is?
Well, you know, I guess at the end of the day, the brass ring... It's actually funny. I used to be able to answer that question more, but the more that I've accomplished and I'm satisfied with what I've done so far. That brass ring, it's not that it's getting further away. I just kind of feel like I'm kind of doing it, and I just want to keep it up.
Yeah, it's a continuum.
The brass ring is the filmography.
Yeah.
The brass ring is an oeuvre that you can be proud of, and everything is of a certain quality that never goes down from that. And I have to say, just looking at that little clip that you had of my movies, I was feeling pretty darn good about myself. But that's
any missteps at all in your judgment?
Well, you know, I mean, not really. I mean, in the case of, like, say, I mean, not as far as writer-director. Not as far, I mean, I've done my side projects.
And that's a mistake.
Yeah.
Was it not?
Well, I learned a lot from them.
Well, you said an interesting thing, too. You said that if you want to be a writer, one damn good thing to do is to go be some kind, go to acting class, go be an actor.
No, I agree with that. Definitely.
What does it give you?
Well, you know, one, it actually... especially if you want to be a writer, actually learning about acting and everything actually just it gives you more of an insight to these characters. I mean, like, I can do what I'm talking about, where I can just get the characters talking to each other and they can just be and they come from me. Well, a lot of that comes from me studying acting as opposed to writing classes. I studied acting classes. Also, as a director, it gives you a sense of how to talk to an actor. You understand, you're walking a mile in their shoes and you kind of understand it.
How to speak to actors if, in fact, you've been an actor.
Exactly. Yeah. No. I mean, that's one of the things about actor directors have it over most other directors that are more technically oriented is they speak actor talk. You know, they know how to elicit things from an actor and make them comfortable. I mean, if you work, I mean, look, I actually believe very much so that if you could make anybody comfortable enough when they're going to perform that anybody could be a really good actor. It really is. Can you make them comfortable? If you could make if you could make anybody your uncle Ernie, if you could make him comfortable enough on camera, he would give a good performance.
Exactly.
It's all about comfort.
Exactly. Christoph in this film it's almost like he has created in his own mind who this character was, which is what a good actor does.
Exactly.
And, and Brad does that with his accent and his style.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. And then he inhabits that character. Mm-hmm. Now, that's not so much being... What's that about, then? I mean, you know the character, and mm-hmm. so you get inside the character, mm-hmm. and you make him become real.
Well, yeah, it's in the case of, like, say, in the case of actually both Christoph and Brad, on one hand, you know, it's right there on the page.
Right.
It's right there. And they don't have to go and find somebody that they can pattern the character after. They have me. I know this person. I can explain who they are. And
so
if they end up living through the war, I can explain to them what happened to them afterwards.
Can you really?
Yeah. Oh, very much so.
You read film criticism. You could make film criticism mm-hmm. if that was what you wanted to do. Tell me about some of the criticism.
Mm-hmm.
It is about what you're doing here.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, first of all, you suffer from this idea that once you made Pulp Fiction, everything would be compared to Pulp Fiction.
Yeah. I don't consider that a suffering, though. You said to me when I came on for Jackie Brown, like, you know, your competition is yourself.
Exactly.
I wouldn't have it any other way. I mean, that's a great place to be. All right? And then everyone's arguing, oh, this is better than Pulp Fiction. No, this was better than Pulp Fiction. No, actually, Pulp Fiction wasn't so good. All right, you know, and there's a whole lot of people. I'd like to the film comment sight and sound crowd actually look at my work and say there's Jackie Brown and then there's everything else.
They really?
Yeah. Jackie Brown has swung completely in the other direction when it comes to the hoity-toity serious American critics.
But you sat down here and you and I were talking about how much we both love Uma Thurman.
Yeah.
And you said you think Kill Bill is maybe your best movie.
Well, it's definitely my most personal movie. I mean, forever, when people would ask me what my favorite film is of mine, I almost felt like sacrilege to say anything but Reservoir Dogs, because it just changed my life, and there'll never be that again, you know? And I actually think it's kind of a perfect movie for what it is, and actually, it's been 17 years, so I can actually say that now without sounding like I'm self-aggrandizing myself. It's just what it is. But I watched Kill Bill Volume 2 just about a month ago. I think maybe spurred on because of David Carradine dying, and I screened a print at my house and watched it just by myself. And at that moment, it was actually became my favorite movie I've ever done. I actually enjoyed it so much. And, you know, it's you know, when I was like joking before about the that masterpiece line, when it comes to this, would I like this to be my masterpiece? Yes, I'd like each new movie to be my masterpiece, and this one's got a lot behind it. But truthfully, as far as me judging it, it would be I'd need at least 3 years of distance to actually really see where it would fit in my oeuvre.
All right, a couple of criticisms. One, and actually, you once were on this program with some critics.
Yeah,
we had a nice, interesting discussion about film. This is David Demme, The New Yorker. Inglourious Basterds is not boring, but it's ridiculous. And appallingly insensitive. A Louisville slugger applied to the head of anyone who has ever taken the Nazis, the war, or the resistance seriously. Not that Tarantino intends any malice towards such earnest people. The Nazis for him are merely available movie troops, articulate monsters with a talent for sadism. By making the Americans cruel, too, he escapes the customary division of good and evil along national lines, but he escapes any sense of moral accountability as well. In a Tarantino movie, everyone commits atrocities, like all the director's work after Jackie Brown. The movie becomes pure sensation.
Now, okay, but one thing. Okay, it's hard to talk about bad criticism about yourself without sounding defensive.
Right.
All right.
Defensive is okay.
Yeah, but the thing about it is, you could actually say that exact same sentence and put a positive spin on it, and that would be actually a positive thing. Right. All right, because it is a method. I actually do have a thing where I actually make it a point not to apply morality to Mike. I am not Quentin being this moral judge on my characters any more than an actor can really terrifically be
so
a moral judge.
If you're looking for moral lessons, don't come to me.
Well, I actually think they're refreshingly free of them. All right, the characters are the characters. Now, one of the things is, on one hand, I've set up this nice little fantasy masturbatory kind of thing of Jews turning the tables on Nazis, and there's an aspect you can have a lot of fun with that. At the same time, like I've always done in my characters, I try to make that very, very complicated. Like, for instance, there's a sequence early on where you see Brad Pitt interrogating a Nazi sergeant.
Right.
And the bear Jew comes in there and does what he does.
That was in the trailer.
Yeah, exactly. Now, the thing about it is, there is this movie kind of moment about it that could be kind of fun. But at the same time, that German sergeant, under any criteria of bravery in the face of enemy, passes the test. And you can't help but even kind of admire the German sergeant for his knowing he's going to die.
He's operating on a code, own code.
Exactly.
A code
of bravery that would apply to anybody
in war. Exactly. A military code.
And even the character of Frederick Zoller.
So do you create him to be, is that in your mind?
Well, it's complicated. It just complicates the myth. It doesn't make it so easy to applaud. You can still
applaud.
There's
no whimpering on that guy.
Yeah, there's no whimpering at all. And by the way, if he was a cringing coward when Donnie the Bear Jew comes out there, it would be a lot easier to have fun at his expense.
Right. No, I agree with you. Now, let me just read one other thing. This is from the New York Magazine. The common view of Quentin Tarantino as a sicko gore freak overlooks his real gift, which is for long and fraught and winding dialogues before the carnage erupts. Watching his World War II action thriller Inglourious Basterds, you might wish the blood would never come. The payoffs are common, but the foreplay is killer. Even more than his other genre mashups, this is switchback journey through Tarantino's twisted inner landscape where cinema and history, misogyny and feminism, sadism and romanticism collide and split and rebond in bizarre new hybrids. The movie is an ungainly pastiche, yet on some whacked out onion level, it's all of a piece. That's pretty good, though.
Yeah, that was a lot of adjectives.
That's pretty good, though. I like that.
Yeah, I like that, too, actually.
I mean, he does get... But so, you know what this says? It says that somehow you are different in terms of filmmakers. You wouldn't have this conversation, or maybe you could, with a lot of other people. I mean, I think of some of the people who've been here recently.
Mm-hmm. Well, look, just for instance, I mean, one of the most talented filmmakers of, my generation is David Fincher.
Right.
All right. But he's not in the same category as me because I'm a writer-director, and that makes it different. That makes it a different thing. You know, and I think one of the things is, one of the things that I've been focused on is there's a lot of writer directors that come out and they write and direct one movie, a second movie, a third movie. Well, there's a real voice there. There's a real voice. But you know what? It's hard work to go to that blank piece of paper and start from square one. Start from scratch every single solitary time. You are at the bottom of Mount Everest every single solitary time, and everything you've done before not only does not help you, it could even, like, hang over your head. And that is a tough road to hoe, and you make less movies that way. And it's a lot easier to go and look at the scripts that are out there and available, and you can maybe work with a writer or do a little rewrite or do that kind of thing, and you get more movies made. But, you know, cut to 6 years down the line, and where's that voice? It's gone away. And I'm proud of the fact that, with the exception of Jackie, I mean, I love Jackie Brown, but I don't really have any intention of doing any more novel things. Never say never, but I don't.
No, nobody. You're not going to adopt anybody else's novel.
No, I mean, I don't see that happening right now. Because to me, the glory in what I do is the fact that it starts with a blank piece of paper. You look at something like Inglourious Basterds, and that did not, if my mother never met my father, that would not exist in any way, shape, or form. If my mother hadn't met my father, there would be no Inglourious Basterds in any way. It started off with a pen and a piece of paper, and now I have a movie.
Say, if you weren't born, there would be no Inglourious Basterds, because only you could create it. Although there was a movie of that title.
Yeah, but that's
made
just
by some Italian.
Yeah, it was a fun movie, though. It's a fun movie, but it's not a remake.
It was made in when? In the 30s?
No. 1978.
Oh, yeah. Had to be the...
And then I changed the spelling of it, too.
Even more of a distance.
It's just an artistic stroke. You know, to actually put it under the microscope
is to... have us ask questions about it.
Well, just to describe it means I might as well not have done it, you know? It's a Basquiat. Basquiat-esque touch.
Oh, Basquiat. Oh, really? Yeah.
Why did he take the restaurant check and then Elmer's glue it to his painting? Yeah. Who knows?
Can you imagine ever wanting to do, from your own pen, a story of a real person, a kind of smart, innovative, different biopic? Let's assume it's someone interesting like Van Gogh or Picasso or someone like that, where there's a creative force to be reckoned with.
Well, I'm gonna say exactly how I feel about that, and then I'm gonna do a little caveat to it. I don't like biopics at all, at all. I think it's one of my it's my least favorite genre.
Why?
I actually think there's hardly anybody whose story from, you know, beginning to end is very interesting. To me,
I could not disagree with you more.
Not for a movie. I mean, to me,
So let's take one example. I mean, this is not what we're talking about. Let's assume something like Patton.
Yeah.
Is that a good movie or not a good movie, in your judgment?
That's okay.
Give me the best. What is the closest story of which maybe they took literary
license? I'll tell you exactly. Okay, if I were going to... Okay, like, for instance, I'll give you an example of something that... I don't want to do it, but it was something I thought about a long time ago. I would not be interested in doing the life story of Elvis Presley, but I could do a day in the life of Elvis Presley. Like, the day he decided to walk into Sun Records and he changed music. Now, that could be an interesting movie. I'm not interested in somebody's whole life, but to actually crystallize it to the moment, and even the idea that, like, the end of the movie is him walking into Sun Records, but what happened to them that whole day? Now, having said that, there is one story that I could be interested in doing, and it would probably be one of the last movies I do, is my favorite hero in America is John Brown.
Exactly.
John Brown is he's my favorite American who ever lived.
Now, why is that?
Because
of what he did?
Yeah, you know.
And what happened to him?
He basically single-handedly charted the road to end slavery. And the fact that he killed people to do it. You know, he decided, okay, we start spilling white blood, then they're going to start getting the idea.
Yeah, how many movies have been made about John Brown?
Not very many. There was one
that people were talking about several years ago.
Yeah, well, there was, Raymond Massey played him as a bad guy in a couple of movies, and he's popped up from here and there in his little parts. But again, I wouldn't go the dreary, solemn historical route. I mean, that actually is a very exciting story about him and his sons, you know, doing these raids and freeing slaves and stuff. That could be a true adventure movie.
You wouldn't have to make it as biographical, do you? You could make it simply.
Well, I would make it true, all right. Yeah.
But you wouldn't have to do his entire life.
I wouldn't. I just don't like that musty thing. To me, those movies are they're showcases for actors, but they're not really showcases for storytellers or directors.
Where does this love of dialogue come from? This sense of, I mean, there's a setup, there's a set scene. Mm-hmm. Your movies are famous for set scenes.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. No, they're very big, they're set piece driven.
Exactly.
Yeah.
There's a set piece that takes place. Yeah. And so you see the competition through words of people sitting at a table like this, and one is trying to detect whether this person is real or authentic.
Yeah.
And it turns out that he's a film critic.
Exactly. Based on Graham Greene, actually, that character.
Graham Greene?
Yeah, he was a commando. He was a film critic and a commando in World War II. Yeah, I mean, it's not. I mean, it's just it's glancing off of the based on him, but it was an idea. But yeah, you know, like to give you an example on that, that's a scene that's built around both dialogue, but dialogue as a mechanism for suspense. Mm. And I remember after I came out with Pulp Fiction, so I had two movies by that time. Some critic said something to the effect of, Tarantino will never be a master of suspense because he's too far in love with minutia. And I actually thought that was a fair enough criticism back then. So now I want to actually do a movie where I actually indulge in suspense and I go for it. And my method of it, and use that scene and the opening scene of the movie as an example, it's like there's the scene above ground and the scene below ground. And the scene above ground is what's going on and the dialogue and them sitting around this table and talking. Underneath it, it's like the suspense is a rubber band. And I'm just stretching it and stretching it and see how far it can stretch. Right. Now, normally in a situation when you do a movie, you try to make your scenes as compact as possible so there's not air and you don't wear out your welcome with the audience. But in this method, as long as that rubber band can stretch, the longer the scene can hold, the more suspenseful it is. That scene is more suspenseful at 22 minutes than it would be at 8. Right. So you want to just stretch it until the rubber band breaks.
David Carradine. Mm-hmm. It is said that because he was in Kill Bill, obviously, you were terribly fond of him, moved by him.
Yeah, very much.
You know, and had a hard time adjusting, you know.
Yeah, it's like, well, you know.
Appreciate David Carradine for us.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think he was one of Hollywood's great, you know, wild man acting geniuses. And he truly had a fantastic life. His autobiography, Endless Highway, is one of the best autobiographies I've ever read. I mean, really, he had a Dickensian life. When you, even the whole being raised by John Carradine and all the stuff he went through. I mean, there is an aspect that when he died, to me, I look at it a little differently than a lot of people. I don't think it's sad for him. I think it's sad for his loved ones. I think it's sad for us who miss him and won't have him around anymore. That guy lived the life of five people, man. He put a lot into that life, and he lived it his way in every way, shape, and form. And that's almost like he lived a Kerouac-style life. Kerouac would have been proud to write about David Carradine. So, you know, and he died an old man. So, I mean, you know, he went out, but as far as I'm concerned, no regrets, living a good life. It's sad. So it's not sad for him. It's sad for us. Mm. It's sad for us who know him because he's not around anymore. Mm.
When you look at your future, what will be the greatest impediment to being able to achieve the things that you want to do? Are you your own worst enemy, or will it be something else?
I hope not. I think the rudder of my boat is pretty good, you know, and definitely so far so good. And if anything, I've learned not to get distracted by side things, which are the things that have my failures.
Things of a normal life?
No. Well, a little bit. Look, just for instance, I'm not married.
Right.
I don't have kids, and I've got nothing against that. About 4 years ago, but within those 4 years, I had a couple of situations that if they had worked out in a different way, maybe I would be married now, maybe I would have kids. And that would have been fine. But, I wouldn't be sitting here at this table talking about Inglorious Bastards.
I don't understand why. Why can't you have kids?
Well, I wouldn't be sitting here right now talking about it.
Okay.
but those little things could have made it very, very, very different. And truth be told, as much as I did have baby fever for a while, but I got over it. Truth be told, I don't want anything to be more important than my movie right now. I don't want this other thing out there that's more important than my movie. I mean, I look at it, the metaphor I keep using, and it's a whipped metaphor, but I use it anyway, is I keep using mountain climbing metaphors. And you know what? This is my time in life to climb Mount Everest. Yeah. And there's other times to hang out in the chalet, and there's other times to, mow the lawn, but this is the time to climb Mount Everest. And I don't intend to climb mountains forever. I don't want to be an old man director, and so I intend. Who knows what's going to happen exactly? But I want to hang up the megaphone at 60, And then that'll be my last movie. That'll be my last film. And then I'll become a man of letters. Then I'll write the novels that I'd like to write now, but I don't want to divide my focus. Then I'll write cinema books and even be more of a professor on cinema.
But right now you don't want to do anything that distracts you from making films.
Yeah, I don't think I can serve two masters right now.
Give me the argument, the best argument you know, for the power of cinema.
Oh, gosh. You know, one of the things about cinema that I just find very moving, it's why it's my favorite art form, is and there's a lot of things, and people have much different aesthetics about what it is that they like about cinema. To me, what gets me is when you go to a movie and you see a certain sequence, and if there is real cinematic power and their cinematic flair. There are certain filmmakers out there that you feel were touched by God to make movies. And it'll be a combination of editing and sound, and usually it's like visual images connected with music or something. But when those things work and they really connect, and you know, an example could be the final gunfight sequence in the Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, like a sequence I can't ever imagine topping. That's like the one sequence I can't ever imagine doing anything that good. It's just like you forget to breathe. You are really transported to a different place. And music doesn't quite do that on its own. And novels don't quite do it. And a painting doesn't quite do it. It does, they do it their way. But in cinema, especially if you're in a theater and you're sharing the experience with a bunch of other people, so it's this mass thing going on. It's just truly, truly thrilling. And if the movie is more than that, if there's a lot underneath, if there's more there, and you go out and you have a piece of pie and coffee and you talk about it and you find that there's more to talk about. I mean, one of the things that's actually fun is if you go with somebody and they don't like a movie and you do and you start talking about it and yet they start digging deeper and deeper in the movie and go, you know, you're not really talking about a movie. It doesn't sound like you don't like it. You're realizing there's a lot there. That's one of the things I love about film criticism when it's really good, is the digging deep. And just to give you an idea about how that affects me as far as my work method is concerned, I never deal with subtext when I'm writing. Ever. I keep it about the text. I keep it about the scenario because I know there's a lot there, but I don't want to know it right now. I don't want to hit that nail hard. I'm really not about hitting it on things on the head. I'm about glancing blows. And I trust that it's full. And I try to be very unanalytical. I'm a very analytical guy, too. I try to be very unanalytical when it comes to both writing and directing. Now, one of the things that's nice about this process right now is it allows me to be analytical. And I actually start seeing what it is I've done.
You mean this process at this table?
Yeah, this process at this table, this talking about the movie, and now it's done, and I've seen it now a few times. I'm starting to see what the subtext is. I'm starting to see what's underneath.
That's the interesting part, is whether you know at the time what all the subtext is or how it's somewhere there, and you act necessarily, not necessarily consciously, but subconsciously. Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, actually, when I went to the Sundance workshop to work on a scene from Reservoir Dogs before I shot it, I shot a scene, and then I got together with these resource directors, and they go, well, have you done your subtext work? I go, what's that? And they go, see, you wrote it, so you think you know everything, but you don't know everything. You need to do your subtext work. I'm like, well, I've never thought about that before, so let me give it a shot. So I took the scene where Mr. White brings in Mr. Orange to the warehouse, and Mr. Orange wants him to take him to a hospital. Seems like a very obvious scene. So I took a piece of paper and I wrote down, okay, what does Mr. White want from this scene? And what does Mr. Orange want from this scene? And what do I want the audience to take away from this scene? Now, the very basic things, especially from where Mr. Orange is coming from, I'm dying and I want to go to the hospital. But just in writing those words, just all this stuff just started pouring out. And that was when I realized it was a father-son story going on, and all these weird connections that happened later. I mean, just little things in the case of Reservoir Dogs, Mr. White keeps saying, well, wait till Joe gets here. And what happens when Joe gets here? He goes to kill him. All right. And Joe is Mr. White's version of a father and all this kind of stuff. So I finished it all, writing this subtext thing about that one scene. And I go, wow, there's a lot there. That was a very interesting exercise. Now I never need to do that ever again. I don't want to know these things. I don't want to know it's a father-son story. I want to keep it up top. I want to keep it about the scenario because now I know it's there. Mm-hmm. But I don't want to know it's there as I'm directing. I don't want to hit that nail hard. I like finding it out now.
It's great to have you here.
It's always great to be here. I look forward to it. In the writing stage, I look forward to coming to this table and talking to you.
Quentin Tarantino, the film, which opens on Friday, August 21st, is Inglourious Basterds, Brad Pitt and others. Thank you for joining us. See you next time.